Behind the Dish is sponsored by DBAT. Check out DBAT.net for baseball and softball products, franchise information, and to find a location near you. And now your host, John Piper.
Welcome to another episode of Behind the Dish. I'm John Piper. We're recording here in Dallas, Texas today. Early January, the baseball season is right around the corner. So pleased to be joined live in studio today with former first-round draft pick with the New York Yankees, 29th overall selection in 2009, a two-sport star at Texarkana High School, football, baseball, state champion, offers from LSU, elects to go with the New York Yankees in the 2009 draft. Welcome, Slade Heathcott.
How are we doing?
Man, hope I got that intro right.
I think you killed it.
Man, it's so good to have you. We spent the afternoon together talking about some things we're collaborating on in the baseball business, and hear your story and to learn more about everything you're doing now and everything that you've been doing in your baseball career is truly phenomenal.
I appreciate it. You know, we're all on this planet together. We need to start acting like it. You know, we have so many people that try to climb over people and think that that's the way to get to the top. And, you know, I have a saying that I always tell people, that if you get to the top of your mountain and you're alone, you're in a mirage in the middle of the desert, because none of us find success, none of us have lasting success by ourselves, and we need to start acting like that and realizing that together we're stronger. Iron sharpens iron.
Well, you know, our audience, a lot of players, a lot of developing players, you know, in that impressionable age, you know, 9, 10, 12, 14, high school players, youth coaches, college coaches, and your story resonates with all of them. You know, we talk about being the first-round pick in 2009, first-round draft pick, $2.2 million signing bonus, obviously a lot of money for an 18-year-old kid at the time.
Yeah, it was a whirlwind of emotions, that's for sure. I didn't grow up with money or a background of money whatsoever, so to get a chunk of change like that at a young age, there was a lot of opportunity there, and you know, I made some decisions that some may think is mistakes and lifestyle choices, but it all led to me now, you know, looking back 28 years later, every choice, every decision, every path that I was on has led me to where I am right now, and I wouldn't change that one bit.
Yeah, I want to bring that up, Slay, because, you know, we were talking earlier today off air about some of the adversity you faced, you know, as a young man, you know, not a great childhood, but you wouldn't be sitting in the chair right now with me if that didn't happen. I wouldn't be sitting here if some adversity didn't happen in my life. And, you know, let's talk a little bit about that, overcoming some of the challenges. You know, you talked, you played summer ball in the Dallas area, or based in the Dallas area with a DBAT elite team. Some of the kids you mentioned, I believe you played with Max Muncy and a few others. Talk a little bit about that team before we segue into you going back for your junior year there at Texarkana.
Yeah, it was, you know, like we were talking with Kate earlier, I wasn't really a known prospect. Even sophomore going into my junior year, I didn't really flourish into what people thought I would be, or the hype that I was given, or the prospect status that I was given, until late. And really it happened when I came to play with DBAT. And, you know, we had Tyler Collins, who played with the Detroit Tigers. We had Max Muncy, who just was in the home run derby. We, you know, going through that list, I'm trying to think of other. And then just, you know, 1 year away, who played with us sometimes, was, you know, Dylan and Archie Bradley. And so the guys that we were around in the Dallas area were very influential. We had a lot of fun. And, you know, when you talk about teams at a young age or professional level, no matter what level you're at, teams that have fun, teams that are able to go out and just play the game to have fun, tend to be a lot better teams. So I think that was huge. You know, having a Rusty Greer coach us was a big influential impact in my life, and somebody that I talked to several times after that and leading up. just for advice and things like that. So, you know, the D-Bat setup that we had that year was phenomenal.
Well, the great Rusty Greer, he's now in the Texas Rangers Hall of Fame. I've met him a few times. He's actually been on the show, and just such a humble guy. I mean, just a genuine baseball guy. You had to learn a lot from having a guy that came from humble beginnings as well in small town in Alabama as your head coach and probably a mentor that summer.
Yeah, I don't think I realized until I was probably 25, going through some life changes of my own, just had my son. Rusty was a big influence even that summer just in my thought process. And golly, I think there was a couple of times that guy wanted to kill me with my attitude and perspective and things it was. But he is. He's just a, you know, not really a farm boy, but just one of those, you know, kind of easygoing, level-headed, good-hearted people that when you get them going, they have some passion and things. So it was very good to be around him. And I said, I think it took 25 years and some things changing in life for me to really realize how much of an impact he had actually made in my life from that one summer.
Slade, we hear from a lot of coaches that we talk to about having the right mindset as you head to the ballpark, as you leave the vehicle to walk into the dugout. Are you saying you didn't always have the right attitude as you entered the ballpark as a young man?
Not even close. You know, mindset is everything. Whether we're playing baseball, whether we are working for DBAT, whether we are a teacher or a janitor, whatever it might be, mindset is everything in life. You know, we go back to the pursuit of happiness and what we all try to do and what we think would get there. It all leads back to being happy, and being happy goes back to your mindset and your perspective. So for me, my perspective changed in 2014 going into the 2015 season. You know, I was told by Dr. Andrews on November 25th, maybe, or 24th, somewhere right around there in 2014, that I would never play another game in my life. And this was after
two. That's pretty tough news right there for an athlete.
Yeah, and I remember the day. It was so 6 months prior to that, doing rehab, I had done – in 6 months or 7 months, I had done 200 rehab sessions with Andrews and API up in Pensacola. And I had moved there for my 2014 season because I didn't really play due to injury. But, yeah, getting told that really changed my perspective. And I still remember this day, and I still send Dr. Andrews a message every year around that time of me doing something crazy. But I told Doc that nobody in this life can tell me what I'm able to do and what I'm not able to do, that the only limits I have are the ones I set for myself. And I remember that being the first day in my life that I walked outside and I looked up and the Blue Angels were actually flying. And I got it, and that was the first day that I walked outside, and I had heard it 6 months prior to this about, you know, your perspective and, you know, your days are controlled by who you are. And I was listening to an audio tape by Zig Ziglar, leadership and how to stay on top.
Dallas based, you know, the Zig Ziglar organization still continues today right here in Plano, Texas, right up the road.
Zig Ziglar's audio tape changed my life and impacted my life more than anything else I've had. My son is up there, but, you know, listening to that was, you know, we control our days and we have mission statement. And, you know, one thing that he was big on was impacting enough lives to change the world. And, you know, that's something that I believe we all have the power to do, and something that we kind of look at as a cheesy saying is we each as individuals have the power to influence the world. And we do. But, you know, something I heard was, you know, every day is a good day. And at the first time that I said that, I'm like, this is the biggest crock that I've heard. This is, you know, like, there's bad days. And don't get me wrong, there are days that are better than others. There are terrible things that happen on a daily basis. But I think the one thing we lose sight on, and it goes back to that perspective, is living a life of having enough and not getting caught up on what other people think about us, but what we have. Each day when I wake up, I take a breath first thing in the morning in my head, and today is a good day. Everything else is icing on top.
Another thing that T's known for, I was fortunate enough to hear some see Zig Ziglar speak in person years ago, as I believe this is his quote, if you help enough other people get what they want in life, you'll get ultimately what you want in life. And I know we'll talk a little bit later here in the podcast about some of the things you're doing now to help others, but it's coming full circle to help Slade Heathcott.
Yeah, I mean, I tell people a lot, and I think it catches people off guard. You know, I've dedicated my life. I knew in 2010 when I accepted Christ in my life, and then going on missions trips, just seeing the impact of the life that we live and the life that others live. And we kind of lose sight of that in the United States sometimes and how third world countries live, and we don't really have that perspective in that regards. But I knew then that my life was going to be dedicated to serving others. And, you know, a smart man once said, several thousand years ago, the greatest among thee would be a servant of all.
Slade, let's take a step back. That's a great segue to where you're living your life now. But that summer that you played ball in Dallas with Max Muncy and the other great players that you mentioned, you travel back to Texarkana and you get home and it wasn't quite what you expected. Can you share with our audience a little bit about what happened in your life and what went on there as you went back to high school?
Yeah, so just before I had left, I had actually, you know, as we were just discussing, I had gotten a DUI the night before. Went out on a Friday night like normal, stayed the night at my buddy's place, got up the next morning early, left, got pulled over speeding, and, you know, I had alcohol in my breath, but so I got a DUI that night. So actually when I moved to Dallas, I actually drove the entire summer without a driver's license. Probably not the best decision in the world, but that's what it was. But before I moved to before I moved to Dallas, I always had a estranged and kind of disconnected relationship with both of my parents. They always argued a lot. They always fought verbally and physically. And it got to a point when I was old enough, probably around 12 or so, that you know, I started realizing that if I made them argue with me or they were mad at me, they wouldn't fight with each other. So that would be my way to get them to stop fighting and what they were doing and, you know, throwing stuff or whatever it might be. But I came back from DBAT after I hadn't lived with my mother for a couple months prior to that and kind of mixed around at that point. But when I came back, I remember just pulling up to the driveway and there being a couple trash bags out right next to the garage door.
And did she knew you were coming home like that next morning?
I hadn't talked to her in a couple months at that point. I still had stuff at the house, but yeah, I pulled up and started looking through the house, and I'm like, well, no one's home. That's weird. And I started looking. I went around to the backyard and started seeing that there was nothing left in the house whatsoever. So I opened the bags, and it was all my stuff. And at that time, I had a little brother that I wasn't sure. I didn't know what had happened. I had got my stuff and, you know, piled it into the back of my truck that I was driving and just went to the baseball field, started calling around. It took me a couple hours to find out that she had married somebody and moved down to Louisiana. And my brother had moved in with a family of the Swangers in Texarkana. So I got back. My stuff was in the driveway. And at the time, it was just, you know, my thought process was, well, I was already on my own anyway, so what's going to change? So, and I always had too much of a pride and ego to ask for anyone's help and still have that issue today.
Hey, ego can get in the way of a lot of things.
Everything.
And we see that a lot in high-performance athletes. Till you surrender, say, hey, coach, it's more about the team than about me. The ego will get in the way.
No question. It's Eckhart Tolle says it's etching God out. And, you know, not necessarily a bad thing to have an ego, but if you don't know you have an ego, there's an issue there. And you got to have it in check daily. And, you know, that's a struggle that I have still to this day is to not have an ego and, you know, to at least recognize when I do. So, but, you know, I was young enough to, you know, it was like fun to me. I grabbed my stuff. I went to the baseball field and I proceeded to live there, you know, my entire senior year on and off. You know, I moved in with Hunter Allday and his family, and I moved in with an ex-girlfriend that I lived there. That didn't last very long, probably not the best setup, but did that. I moved in with the Alldays, and, you know, I lived out of my truck at the baseball field.
And we were talking, sometimes you would go 7-10 days literally living in your truck before you would maybe take a friend's offer or a family's offer to come spend a couple nights with them. Must have been challenging. I mean, it's hard to imagine any high school senior being on their own, much less being homeless.
Yeah. You know, like I said, I was young at the time, and it was something that I really enjoyed. Now looking back, I still to this day, like I made a pledge in 2019 when I was by myself and traveling, I would never get a hotel room. I would stop at state parks and throw my backpack, my hammock up or whatever. And it just it relates back and kind of gets me back to that point. You know, I told you when I had done playing, I had taken the time to really think about what I was trying to do for minor league players and stuff. And that just got back to checking that.